Welcome to our Highland studio and this Masterworks oil painting reveal, in which we take you through the process of creating Ghosts of Summer, one of my favorite paintings. This painting took well over 5 years to complete, and although I was painting other paintings at the time, I'm pretty sure that this particular painting took at least a year in its own right. And you will certainly see the reason why as you see the reveal later on. You may have wondered why this painting is called The Ghosts of Summer. Well, it's a very special painting to me, and I wanted a very special name. And The Ghosts of Summer, first of all, relate to the trees and the autumnal shade they're starting to acquire. I thought of the leaves very much as the ghosts of summer because they're changing in their nature. They're becoming something quite different. They're still there. They're still apparent, still on view. But of course, they're becoming more magnificent in their color. The other thing was very much the fact that when we were there, the sound of the water was really everywhere. And when you hear the gurgling and the dripping and the movement of the water, and it's so all-encompassing, your imagination starts to wander and you start to hear voices within the water. And I thought they too could be the ghosts of summer. I knew that this was going to be a very wide painting. And from experience, I know that wide paintings need several focal points. I didn't know what those focal points were going to be exactly, but Eileen was there on the side of the river, and she was perfect because she was going to be a wonderful focal point, and she was also going to give scale to the painting. There's nothing else within the composition which gives size, really. The rocks could be any size, the trees could be any size, but she was there perfectly catching the light. My long acquired knowledge of traditional techniques and how to exploit them is essential when working on a grand vista such as this, which requires the build-up of many layers, gradually working through from the darkest recesses to the lightest sparkling highlights. Layering is essential. It allows the initial buildup of texture using directional brushstrokes of impasto, that's thick paint, through to the finer, thinned down mixes of glazes and tints. With each subsequent layer of impasto, followed by glazes and tints, the overall colour and balance across the entire painting is refined, so that I realise the effect of light and shade that I had in mind when first plotting out this composition. There is absolutely no rushing this process. It requires meticulous attention and considerable patience. For the overall result has to be reassessed along every step on this journey of discovery. The result is almost inevitably an unexpected delight, and it is this that drives me to push the limits of my work. The traditional technique of impasto not only allows me to create texture and movement with directional brush strokes, the very positioning of those strokes will also affect how light falls on the surface of the painting, which in turn influences the viewer's experience. Glazing with transparent colored mixes of paint allows me to selectively enrich and enliven specific areas of impasto. Tinting with fluid mixes of light-colored semi-opaque paint allows me to push back specific areas, which in effect throw forward other elements, thus creating distance, depth, and volume. We discovered this on one of our rambles. We were on the lower part of a hill and Eileen heard some water in the distance behind a lot of vegetation. And she, being more adventurous than me, was off. And I followed in her wake. It was quite a job to get through all of the undergrowth. In fact, we had to crawl on hands and knees to get through. And finally, when we burst through, this was the view that confronted us. And as you can see, it was absolutely spectacular. The view itself is a 180 degree view of what we saw. So if you start your gaze in the center of the painting and then look left and then right and then back again, you'll get an idea of what we saw when we emerged from all that undergrowth. We were right on the water's edge. So it was really difficult. It would have been almost impossible to put up an easel there and paint the view. We couldn't have got the easel through in the first instance, and we were right on the water's edge itself. So I took a lot of photographs, hundreds in fact. At the time, I had no idea how they were all going to fit together. Because there were several layers in this composition, the foreground with the rocks and the trees, then the river itself, and then on the other side, all of that brush and underbrush and trees through which the sun was shining. The perspective itself was strange because I had to twist to see everything. I had to move through that 180 degrees. I was so close to the water. So I wondered whether it would ever make a painting. But as usual, I kept on taking the shots. And every little bit of that scene was recorded. When we got back to the studio, we whittled the photographs down to around about 20 in number, but there was still an incredible amount of information within them, which had to be all pulled together. So I started off simply drawing in my sketchbook, and I soon realized that in some way I was going to have to control all of the elements. They had to be held together somehow. So I started off with as wide a rectangle as I could and started again to put these bits of information in. You can imagine that each one of these, for example, this tree here, this branch here, that's one photograph in its own right, as is each piece of this composition. So each of these had their own little photograph. And in this particular sketch, you can see that we're looking more upstream, really. So we have more information on the right than you have in the final composition. Not enough, I felt, of the water itself. So again, I thought, well, I must start another drawing and think about another tree, in fact, which was coming in from the right. So I did this drawing. You can see this branch coming in from the right-hand side. There is less on the right now, and we're certainly getting more of the water, and we're looking downstream as well. But I did start to feel that
this tree on the left and this tree on the right could work together, they could really make a framework. You'll see if you look at the final painting, they frame the top of the painting. And then the rocks at the bottom form a large sort of bowl, if you like, which is holding the composition together. I started, in other words, to understand how the composition could be controlled. All of those elements could be put together. And here on this little thumbnail, you can start to see that I really simplified it in my mind by keeping out all of the shading and just simply thinking of the rectangle itself and those two trees coming in and how the rocks would work beneath them. And that really, although that's an incredibly simple drawing, that's exactly what I was aiming for. How all of those photographs were finally brought together and tightened up. And then I started to place this on another drawing. I realized that these small drawings would not in themselves be enough. This was a good starting point, but I thought this was a perfect chance to do a full-sized cartoon. A cartoon being a drawing which is the full size of the finished painting, and which therefore could take in these simple elements that I've got now, but also start to think about how all these individual little elements could actually start to fit together in the final painting. Here is the full-scale cartoon. It is the full size of the painting, and it is not a finished drawing, as you can see. It's there to start to, first of all, hold the composition, work out exactly what the composition is, and also to work out the movement, not the movement of the water, but the movement of the elements, how the eye is going to be led across the painting surface. It's all pencil, worked from mid-values in pencil, and then worked both towards the darks using a graphite stick, a very thick pencil, and worked back towards the lighter colours by actually erasing marks from the surface with an erasable putty rubber. You can see it's very vigorous. That was the whole idea, really, keeping the composition at this stage incredibly vigorous, because I knew that the final painting was going to be very complex and detailed. So again, I was looking for the simple elements within the composition at this stage. The control really has to come in at this point, otherwise the painting would just become over complex, and I needed to work out exactly how everything was going to lie.